Hello explorers and welcome to another video. Today I'm going to talk about Polymer 3 and Webpack and how to package your Polymer 3 application with Webpack. And this is actually a question I got from D. Raj. Sorry if I'm not pronouncing your name correctly. So the question was pretty much, if you have a Polymer 3 application, how would you set up your Webpack configuration in order to package your Polymer 3 application? And this is my application that I want to package. It's very simple. It's just using my VC input, an image, and a header. It's not that important, the application, but I wanted to have some assets in it. I wanted to have another component in it. And I also wanted to have the standard test from the Polymer 3 application. So you get all those bits. So let's look at the application a little bit more. So if we go in here, we can see that this image is index.html is actually the standard things. You have some viewport, manifest, you have the component, and then you have a service worker down here that you start up. And then we will look in how to create this service worker as well. And then we have the component. Not much here as well. We import our other component that we want to use. And this is a web Polymer element. And we have some template with some stuff in it, a property, and then we create that. So let's look at the package JSON. So this is where all the scripting is inside here. First off, we need a lot of things. We need the web component polyfill, because today you have support in Chrome, Safari, Opera, and now Firefox with the latest version. But Edge is still in development, so still we need a web component JS polyfill if you want to run it on Edge. And I think this is something that will be removed in the future, and maybe you don't have any customers or users for your website using Edge, so you might skip it by now. And then we have this clean Webpack plugin. It's just to clean up. Concurrently is to run two things at the same time, or many things at the same time. We have a copy Webpack plugin. We have an HTTP server. And this is actually not used, this HTTP server, because I use this static HTTP 2 server instead. We have a Polymer CLI. We have a Lighthouse. We have the service worker precache plugin. We have the web component tester browser legacy, and also the web component tester full package. We have Webpack CLI, Webpack dev server, and Webpack merge. So there's a lot of dependencies here. And then we have the dependencies required for my application. My start script here opens the dev server with the Webpack dev.js. I have a Webpack configuration for building, for the production side of things. And then my test script here runs a build first off, and then we do a web component tester with the --npm flag in order to say that everything is packaged with npm. And then we run the test Lighthouse script down here. And this will concurrently start the HTTP 2 server in the dist directory that we built earlier, and it will run Lighthouse on the port that opens up with that server. So that's the scripts I have. So let's look a little bit more into the actual Webpack configuration. So I have a common Webpack configuration here, and I will use the clean and copy plugin and path. And first off, we set up an entry. So this is my actual application component that we built up here. And then we clean the dist directory. We have some copy things here. I will copy all my assets, my images, and they will be copied from the image directory to the image directory of the dist directory. And then I will copy the index.html to the dist directory. And in the image folder I also have the fav icon, and I will move that too, and that will remove a a load error in the browser that will make my Lighthouse score a bit lower, so I added that as well. And then we have a fancy string here, copy this web component JS polyfill, so you will have that as well, and that you can load it the normal way. And then we output the bundle JS with everything that we have packaged in our entries down here. So we will use the entry name of this web component, and then we will push that to the dist directory. So the entry name is up here, app entry. So this will be added down here to name app bundle will be created. So if we look in the index.html, it's the app bundle JS that we will add as a module, and I will use cross origin attribute when I load it. The reason I don't use the HTML plugin, because I looked into that as well, the Webpack HTML plugin, but it didn't support the cross origin attribute, and I didn't think that I actually got any extra functionality in that plugin and using a template rather than just copying the file. So maybe there is some reason, but I didn't really find any good reason why I should do that. And my web dev server here, then I will set it into the mode development. I will create an inline source map, and the dev server will have a content base of dist, and then we will just copy a fake service worker file into that directory just so we can load something and don't get any load errors. And the fake service worker is just an empty JS file, so it's nothing and it will not be loaded. And if we look at the production environment, then this is a little bit more interesting. First off, we set up some paths up here, and we have the pre-cache Webpack plugin. We have also copy Webpack plugin. We set up a public path, and this will be used as an fallback. So you can use this and set your path to where you will publish this application. And then we set production mode. We say that we want source maps as well. This could be removed if you're not interested in source maps. And then we do a copy of the manifest files. We have that in our dist directory, and we actually get an actual application of this. So I have created the manifest and all the images required to get the manifest working correctly. So you get the install prompt for your application. And the service worker pre-cache plugin, you need to give it a cache ID, and this is where it will save everything in your local storage. So when your application is running, it will save all the cached files into this ID here. And then you have some URLs that you don't want to cache. You have this bust URLs matching rule. And then we have the service worker file that it will create, and it will be minifying that file. We will have this navigation fallback, and that was what I talked about earlier, where it should send you if it can't load the actual resources. And then we have some static file ignore pattern here, so it will remove the asset manifest JSON and the map file, so those will not be cached. So this is the Webpack setup. I also have this little VCT, the web component tester configuration. I've set it to verbose, and I skip update checks. Then that will speed up the testing a bit. And in Windows, you need to set this flag or else it will never run. It takes forever in Windows for some reason. And I have just chosen to use Chrome at the moment. Chrome and Firefox will work, I believe, but as a time constraint, I didn't want to do that. So let's try to now we have run the dev server. So let's go over and start the build. So let's do the build, npm build, just so we can look into the npm run build, of course. So we will run the webpack here and we will get the dist directory. So if we look here, we have all the images I talked about earlier. We have the node modules where we have copied this web component. We have the app bundle and everything here is minified and ready to run. And then we have the index.html looks as before, and the service worker. Here we can see that it will cache the app bundle. It will cache the fave icon. It will cache our images and everything that we use in the application, so you can run it offline if you like. So that's the dist directory. Let's run the tests as well. So npm tests, and this will take some time. First off, we build, that goes quite fast. And here, when it loads the plugin and the configuration, it actually hangs for a while. And then I will wait for that and then resume as it's starting. I'm not really sure what we are waiting for. In that case, it was about 3-4 minutes where it didn't do anything. And now it's ran the tests. All the tests went through. These are standard tests. And now it runs the Lighthouse and creates the Lighthouse report. And everything is done. You see here that it failed with some error code because the HTTP2 server didn't shut down correctly. It just threw it down, and that doesn't really matter if you're not running this in an environment where you actually need to look at the error code to see if any errors occurred. So we see here that the performance is almost 100. I have had it at 100 before, so I guess it's because we are actually taping now or creating this video. It has a little bit less of a performance. No worries, and it's almost a progressive web app, and the reason it's not, it's because we not use HTTPS, and this is something that I wanted to do, but setting up a certificate and creating a trust in the browser and so on, I thought that was not worth it, and it's not really the main focus of this video. I have a video where I talk about how to create the self-signed certificate and how to work with that in a Docker environment. So you can go and look at that video if you like for those details. But you can see here that we get a good report that we can work on, and we can rerun this locally in just by running tests for our webpack. So this is how I would set up Webpack and run tests, and how I would set up my dev environment if I wanted to work with Webpack. You could of course add linters if you're into that, and you can add all the other Webpack tooling for different needs in your development. But this is the bare minimum that I would set up, at least. I hope that you found this video interesting, and all the code is available in the description below. You can go to the GitHub repository. If you have any comments, questions, ideas, leave them in the comments section down below. If you like this video, give it a like, share it with your friends and colleagues. And if you haven't subscribed yet, please do that. And I really hope to see you in the next video.